Okay, guys, so maybe what would help us...
Something interesting in architecture in relationship to what you just said of medium being an history of what has been produced by that medium, or with that medium, is that also, at least in architecture, as I see it, there's several layers of that, what that history is. One is definitely visual, like we were talking before, but another is also how you actually navigate and you understand things that have been consolidated in time, such as typologies, and the way in which they organize within the building.
The history of structures, the history of techniques, the history of solutions.
Yeah.
I mean, you can also think in poetry, different rhythms, different editing styles, absolutely, right?
And the history of structures.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah, no, in the sense, it's exactly that there is a, that also creates virtual entities that are typical of that period. So the way in which we recognize in space that exists, there is a certain relational properties that create programs, for instance, so the program of a lobby, the program of a bathroom, and how they are connected to each other, but also how they emerge out of that connection. So the fact that there is a, that we read in this definition the idea of culture, the idea of technical language, and that we use that to navigate is very clear for this kind of, both disappear, the, you know, the death of the medium and long live, right?
Yes. So what I'm going to write, and I'm going to basically say, is going to be history, which consists of, we can say, particular objects, techniques, and also, I don't know how they call this, conventions? How do you call like this different, for example, type of programs, different solutions? Like, we're not really conventions, but we're not techniques, because it's something which is more high level than techniques, right?
Lexical, but not necessarily only to sign. Your
ambient
doesn't necessarily require that there is kind of a
sign language
that
goes into
sign.
Well, what I'm going to do, just, you know, because I'm going to think about techniques, something which is more like low level. And I'm going to think about something which is more high-level strategies, although I think it's like really kind of continuing, right? For example, is a high-key lighting is a technique or is a strategy, right? You know, I mean, it's not the best thing, but I think it's okay. And finally, you can say that, I can say that has I can say also different representational capacities, right? Which have to do with, you can say, like, different kind of, right, different sense, right, different sensorial. Well, we can simply say that they're kind of, right, processed by different senses. Right? Okay. Yeah, so this is also our thing, so. And I'm sure there's more. Okay, guys, so what I'm going to do now is we have a, 30 minutes. Let's go look at a particular way in which not only all these new things manifest themselves, but once you start looking, you know, in detail, you find more interesting things, right? There's more. Okay. Yes. And most of you find, no, did anybody actually look at the draft of my book, because maybe you already know it? Yeah. Okay. Okay, so, you know, so basically I'm just going to repeat the main arguments, but maybe also something new. Okay. So this is basically, right? Okay, so this is, so okay, so when, so, so basically, you know, we're going to add, like, now, so what now we're going to do is we're going to switch, right, from looking at the computer and what's around it, the interface, the cloud, to what kind of objects, right, whatever media objects that people produce with computers, right? So how do all these new dimensions, these new features, these different capacities affected media statics in the last 15 years, right? So we can say, are there some common features, for example, shared by, you know, motion graphics or graphic design, despite receiving infinite variety? And why do we have such a variety, right? And also you can say, well, I mean, do we still have multiple mediums? Which just becomes one mini medium.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Okay, so this is, you know it. Okay, so we're going to talk about, as I said, this short moving image forms as opposed to the narratives, because I think the long narratives in some ways are much more like 20th century films. Also, we're not going to talk about music media, because it's basically almost opposite of professional graphics, right? It's very raw. So this is typical examples, right? motion graphics, and you know, which can be ads, commercials, flash interfaces, short experimental films, right? Anything from what you see on your ATM to something you can see in the film festival. So I think the first thing which happens is what I call hability or simple immiscibility. And maybe I should simply call this immiscibility. Okay? And this is something which we already theoretically discussed. Right? The previously separate media started to be combined numerous ways. By the end of the 1990s, the pure moving image becomes an exception, and hybrid media become the norm. But here's what's really important. So let's say by middle of the 1990s, it becomes technologically possible to combine drone images, vector graphics, let's say maybe something you shot, some live action video you shot, maybe you shot some kind of stop animation, to do animation, 3D animation. It's like, okay, but what's interesting is this new possibility doesn't seem to become one artistic technique. I'm going to suggest that if you actually start looking at lots of motion graphics, a majority of them, where a whole aesthetic is based on mixing media which you couldn't mix before. So this new technical possibility, for whatever reasons, which I don't completely understand, is projected and I think becomes one of the dominant aesthetics of our era. And this is not remixed in the sense of remixed content, it's remixed in the sense of remixing different mediums or different types of representations. So this is just, I just took two demo reels, and if you look at them, not every single clip, but majority of clips, where whole static is about 3D mixing, to do 3D, vector and raster, right? And it's kind of amazing. I mean, once you kind of realize it, you start looking, you realize that the pure medium, in these short forms, becomes really an exception. Right? So this is really, you can see, medium of the message. So that's one, what about this guy, okay, you can also play this guy. Okay. And you know, because I'm really interested in the effect of software on like visual language, like I basically just take activity as something random, right? So it's not like any kind of famous person, right? It's just, you know, by some people. Okay. Okay, so every single thing. So, right, so what I would say is that in many works, now, how many I don't know, because I would actually have to go and count. Is it 40%, is it 70%? Well, you know, I can go, right, get a sample of 500 works and count, but it can be nice if we can merge it. Right, so this is, you know, going to be, this particular video, which was, you know, quite well known in 2005, so it, because it combined Kanye West and also one of the most prominent motion graphic studios, MK12. So this beginning, I think, is a very classical example of this kind of remixability, and not remixability of content, remixability of different mediums, of different presentational forms, right? I'll play video. So that's why I don't want to use, I don't just say remixability, right? I should really be saying, but the fact that I should do is actually change it right now, because with your help, you can say that it's not simple remixability, you can say it's remixability of mediums, right? I don't know, of media, right? Of media. So that's why it's, you know, it's not just something very simple. Wonderful, thank you guys. Okay, it's 300 keynotes. Thank you, it's nice to have, it's nice to have this editable document, right? It takes forever, whatever. And I mean, I think word hybridity is not a good one because it's already used, but I just don't know how else to call it, right? Well, it's an instability, but it takes a lot of content, an instability, not only of content, but there is instability of, right? The aesthetics of different mediums. It's like stylistic. It's like stylistic, but it's more like representational, right? Because within 3D represent things differently. Right? So that's why I think what I said before was actually kind of okay.
We can't just simply call it hybrid media, or does that?
Well, we can call it. I'm going to it's kind of obvious, but I think what made it not obvious that when this particular technical possibility really becomes so central to our aesthetics.
Okay, so that's one thing. So you kind of see it here, right? You go from time, right, to kind of stylized, right, and a design of 3D. And then you start adding photographs and the photorealistic elements, people, and you see this in the corner, this is another medium, it's kind of particle system, right? Mm. Now you go back to 2D, right? And the whole video is like that. And here you have something there. What is this? Right? I mean, now we're just thinking, of course, if you look at like this thing here, right? Oh, what is this, right? You don't know how to call this, right? It's like a really pure digital image. Anyway, okay, now we're going to talk about the next thing, which I'm going to call digital accessibility. Okay. And so what I would say is the most typical image, right? I mean, this is maybe, I mean, I don't know all the degree of your note, but I think typically when I think of novel remix, I would say, okay, well, you know, you go and you mix different songs, right? With different records. Or, let's say you're making an anime music video, you're going to take anime, you're going to put some soundtrack from MTV, and maybe also remix different animes. So what you're really doing is remixing different, also content in different media, which is very much a 20th century collage or montage, right? So I think that to me maybe one of the most fundamental changes, right, is that in addition to what we talked about before, right, how the ability to combine different medium in terms of a stylistic and representational capacity comes in the foreground, there is also something else. There's a very kind of deep, very deep transformation of what media is. Right? So what basically gets remixed, right, are not only the content, not only the style, it's also the techniques of different media and their interfaces. Okay. Right. So this is kind of what I mean by data medium. Okay. Now, why does it happen? Well, it happens because you can ask yourself, what happens if you simulate mechanical or electronic media in a computer? Okay. Well, like what happens when you do Photoshop? You're basically going to create different tools which are going to simulate various brushes and etc. And then you're going to also sort of add our code which will simulate different canvases, different papers. So what you're doing is you're basically taking medium with all its elements, and every element becomes an algorithm. Right? So before we had these mediums which were kind of wholesale, here's printing, right? Here's photography, here's film. You break them apart into components, into elements, and all these elements become algorithms. And it becomes very easy to combine them. Right? This is what happens, right? So now you go to Photoshop, and, okay, I guess we can go here. And, you know, so basically you can say all the different representational techniques which humans invented until like 95 are here. And of course, it's not the same thing as working with clay or fresco, but in terms of it's a different feeling. But the ideas are here, right? So here's our paintbrushes, right? Here's our pens. Here's our kind of photographic manipulations. Here's our different artistic medium. So all these different things are now combined. Why? Well, because ultimately, you no longer have different physical materials. Right? You don't have paper, canvas, stone. You just have pixels. And all these operations are doing the same thing. We're basically modifying pixel values. Okay? So the combination of universal, we can say, medium not really digital code. In this case, it's a different thing. It's a kind of pixel representation. Right? And the fact that all the techniques are algorithms which are work on the same representation allows for this new condition where you're basically extracting
like all the techniques from different media, now you can offer them in one application. And if something is missing here, right, I can rasterize my image, I can go to Illustrator, and now I have more stuff, right? And as you know, the way basically designers today work, right? You know, you start a project in Illustrator, then you complete something in Photoshop, then you get to make something in Final Cut, then you go to load this all in After Effects. You basically have a whole palette of different mediums, different techniques, and it can be all combined because at the end all you're doing is just changing pixels.
Do you see this as being connected at all to the idea of media convergence? Like as...
Well, what is media convergence, right? What do you mean by media convergence?
Well, I see it as being sort of two things. You know, the idea of media converging on this sort of hyper level, but also in terms of accessibility, like where one sort of gadget will play or access or allow you to manipulate multiple media. And in this case, it's not the medium, it's the gadget or the tool, it's the software.
Well, I would say that for me it's a separate thing. And I would relate by giving convergence to the whole concept of multimedia.
Mm-hmm.
That's why we have like multimedia messaging, right? The fact that you have a phone or computer and it can show you images and text. And to me this is like, it's a much earlier thing, right? I mean, you wouldn't have deeper mixability, but I think that this convergence, it sort of happens, in 1975, right? When Alan Kay develops the first modern media computer, the Spark, and it's very important for him. So it was, basically it was the first computer which has a raster screen. And because the screen is a pixels, it can show you type, images, and animation. Okay, and then let's say later on this is migrated to the phone. But I think this media convergence sort of happens from a point of view of a single device already in 1975, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So to me, like, you wouldn't have Metamedia without it, but to me, this idea of Metamedia would actually have maybe something else in it. Because it's really basically saying, well, it's not only that one device can show me, can play music, play videos, it's basically the fact that as a creator, right? Because we still retrieve media from point of view of creators, right? As a creative, I have access to all these different tools and techniques, and I can combine them in one project, right?
Mm-hmm.
But maybe I show you some examples, right? Okay, so this is one example, right? So one example is that you take a technique which originally only worked with particular media, with particular material, and you now apply it to something else, right? So for example, you could take typography and animate it within this space. You can take a motion blur, which was really kind of a technique or an artifact of, again, photography and film, apply to computer graphics. So let me show you one example, right? And the thing is, these things are so ubiquitous, you never think about them. So let me show you an example, right? So, for example, like you see here, so it's basically a very simple lens blur, right? What is this lens blur? I mean, there is no lens blur in the computer. Originally, you say it was an artifact on the camera. And of course, you can also use this artifact as creative techniques, right? If you do some landscape photography. So you isolate it, you make it into a filter, and now you can apply this filter to anything on your canvas, right? So now we're applying this to actually three-dimensional virtual space. Now, the same thing, of course, works in music, right? So if you have a sound composing program, it's going to have a filter like echo. Well, echo is something which is really property of particular physical spaces. It's now simulated as an algorithm, and now you can apply the echo to any composition you want. Okay? So the idea is that you're basically taking technique which originally only worked with particular materials, and you virtualize it, and you can apply it to anything else. Now, you can say, well, it's kind of interesting. Is digital media the only place where it happens? Of course not. So I think all this excitement today about new materials, it's exactly the same thing, right? Like people make some kind of new alloy, like where you create something which is very light and very strong, right?
So I think new materials is another area where it happens. But with digital media, it's almost like a default. Let me show you one more example. Oh, this is something else. Okay, this is another thing. Right? So we can say what kind of happens when people simulate with techniques of pre-computing media in a computer is when these techniques are changed, right? Where range and applications, where range and application are extended, where controls are made explicit, formalized, quantifiable. So let me show you, this is a perfect example, right? So this is the opening of a particular video clip. So what we have is, a 3D type. This 3D type is moving towards the viewer. And what you do is you basically simulate, right, a particular effect which was possible with film and video, right, which is a wide angle lens. And you're also simulating the artifact with this effect, which is the depth of field, right? And you basically generate it. Okay? So when these letters come closer, look what happens, right? I mean, it kind of looks like, it actually looks like a depth of field effect, but actually, I don't think you'll ever see anything like that in film, right? So what also happens when you translate these techniques into the digital format, we're no longer the same techniques, right? So, for example, typing in Microsoft Word looks like typing on a typewriter, but it's actually a very different thing. Okay, so maybe we'll just kind of finish. So this is the last thing, right? So what I tried to do in this, you know, this part of the book, I said, you know, I'm going to think about modern design, right? Architecture, motion graphics, graphic design, and are there some common properties, right? Which many of these projects share. And again, the idea is that it's not like postmodernism where everything is postmodern. No, basically, if I would look at motion graphics and I find with 50% combined different media, well, that's 50% is a lot. So I'm going to propose the last thing, which again, not saying that every project has this property, but I think many do. So I think that 20th century media was very much defined by cuts, right? It's this kind of heartbreaks between elements. Whether we have cuts in film, between shots, or in photomontage. Right? And in some ways it had to do with technology. Right? Because what you do is you take different pieces and you overlay them in like a photo collage, or you combine them in time, right? And you couldn't really do, you know, it's kind of hard to do something smooth. I mean, you can do cross-dissolve, but that's about it, right? Now, what happens in the computer is that software offers you now different ways to combine elements, but it also offers you something else. So if I create a square in Final Cut or After Effects, I immediately get controls which allow me to animate the square over time by changing its shape, color, etc. So it's almost my ability to change the form over time or in space becomes a new default. Okay? Right. So this is basically the summary. Right? So one of the differences that I think between modernism and contemporary aesthetics is that we have a simple form which changes, which continuously changes in time or in space. Okay, so this is my examples, right, for modernism. Right, the examples of this kind of collage aesthetics. And what I'm suggesting is this is of course Villa Savoy by Le Corbusier. Well, it's a kind of collage, right? Because it's really juxtaposition with contrasting volumes. Okay, if I say something stupid, you'll correct me, right? So far it's okay? And this is, of course, what I showed you before. It's a kind of form, but what's interesting, right? Like if you think about this form, and this is a kind of more symmetrical, it doesn't just change, right? It doesn't just change one dimension, it kind of changes the multiple dimensions. This is maybe not the best example, right? Okay. So in fact, I guess you can say it's not a perfect example because it actually changes, right? No, but I'm saying like it's like, I think if you cut it in one direction, you're going to see more change in another direction, right? Because it's kind of symmetrical, right?
Okay, so this is Genova, right? You can have a terminal by four novice architects. And this is actually my favorite contemporary architecture building. First time I spent 4 hours there. Second time I spent 2 hours. Why? Because it changes every single direction, right? Like there is no symmetry. There's no symmetry. And here's the same example with contemporary motion graphics. And just to make sure people don't be upset with me, I said, okay, I'm going to put some hard fuel. So watch this, right? It's exactly the same thing, but in time. Basically, what the camera is doing, it's navigating for a virtual house. It's actually based on a short story, Crystal World, by J.C. Ballard. And while you're moving through this house, the rendering, right? The rendering changes continuously, right? So it's a kind of this continuous form, which changes over time. Which, of course, would be really impossible to do without contemporary software. Right? Where all I have to do is animate parameters. Now, of course, you can always find previous examples, right, with experimental animation in the film, but the idea is that what used to be kind of exception really becomes more of a norm. Guys, I'm so sorry, I feel a little bit bad because I think I kind of throw lots of stuff at you, but I mean, if you want more, so you can go and read my draft. I kind of apologize, but I think we also need to have time for evaluations. Okay, but okay, we still have 10 minutes for discussion. Okay, I'm done. So sorry, I'm so sorry. So this is just more examples of continuous form, or continuous form. It can be, for example, way this, right, these objects are continuously changing their kind of form, or the way the camera continuously moves. And again, I very much see it as a simple artifact of the interface, right? And the tools of software, such as Final Cut, After Effects. Now, as an architect, what do you think about this argument? Something to think about. Right?
Yeah.
As architects, normally don't think about motion graphics.
No, we do, because we have this representation. Like the entire thing about the fact that the film industry came into the representation.
Right.
And change the way in which you could navigate through models, but then how you could also animate models. I mean, the entire rendering animate form is
based on this, absolutely.
It's based on
this. It's based on it, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. Well, this is basically, this is looking at this like 50 years later, right? I think you can say, okay, this is what we have now, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Guys, I'm sure that there were some questions about this, and maybe it just was too much. But you know, I think you got a lot in the last 3 hours, so I think, you know, and again, if you want more detail, I think, you know, you can go look at the cheapest part of the book. But let's see if there are some questions right now.
I want to follow up on something that you said about the venue as being part of the medium.
Yeah, but it's a kind of platform, right? What they call platform.
Well, how can we apply that to ubiquitous computing?
Yes.
That's the whole, it becomes the world, it becomes everywhere where you're walking.
So, I mean, this is a total leap here, but it sounds like if you apply the idea of venue to medium to, you know, ubiquitous computing, and the world becomes a medium.
That's beautiful. That's beautiful.
But that just seems too radical. That
well, I mean, I think that is too radical, because look, what is ubiquitous computing? Well, okay, so now people are coming up with miniature projectors, which is like built on your iPhone. Okay, but you're still going to project the image, right? I mean, you still have to have a projector, right? I mean, I don't think ubiquitous computing means that you're walking around and just media just materializes out of the air, right? You still have to have some ethical support, right? Okay, so you can say, okay, you don't need to put a screen, you can project any surface, but, you know, it kind of happens in stages, right? So, you know, so the world does become a medium, but and maybe it will one day, but I think it's going to be like a gradual process, right?
I think it already is, with science and things like that.
Well, you can also say, that look, think about medieval city, it was full of science, but it was not interactive, right?
Right.
But I mean, yeah. But basically, you can see retrospective computing already happened. It's called mobile phone. Right? It's called smartphone. That's basically. But again, it's not like embedded. Like,
yeah.
Oh yeah, or for example, people put stuff in clothing, right?
Yeah.
Well, I wrote about this like 8 or 9 months ago because someone talking about seeing a beautiful sunset on a beach in Costa Mesa, and he looked down the beach and there were 150 people holding their phones up, videotaping it instead of looking at it and enjoying it. And so the medium then transports to whatever end user device that they're shipping off to, and they a lot of times don't even know what that is. So they may be transmitting, all of a sudden the person is using the world as a content that they transmit in real time to someone else's computer or phone or whatever. So it really messes with the entire concept of being present in the world.
Well, you know where you see it a lot, and this is actually something lots of people complain. So if you ever go to Asia, right, you go to a museum, people are not looking. All they're doing is taking pictures, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of amazing.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember, like, we had some discussions. I was participating in Shanghai Biennial. One of the artists is a critic, and we had a discussion, and I was very smart, well-known sociologist. Okay, I forgot his name, sorry. He said, well, I don't know what to think. You know, we're basically looking and taking pictures, so... But at least we're taking pictures, right? Anyway. Well, but you know, I think this whole thing about computer computing is really, really interesting, right? It can be a whole separate class.
I guess I need to like bring something up. If I'm
please. No.
I'm very interested exactly in the issue of programmable matter and how that is a sort of conundrum that joins these two things about ubiquity. The fact that there's a lot of processes of matter that are ubiquitous in the world, meaning, you know, the way a brick reacts here and there, or across the other side of the ocean, and the fact that we use those properties in a ubiquitous manner to formulate other things, to synthesize things. But then at the same time, we are more and more, with the smart materials and the metamateriality concept,
yes,
we're more and more creating things that were supposed to be dead, and they're more and more. Yeah, and they're becoming more and more alive, and so they're also starting to communicate at a distance.
Yes.
And this is where I think that the argument of InfoViz and of Metamedia and architecture and space and architectural concepts for space as something that is offered both culturally, that is offered culturally. Point is really converging.
Mm-hmm.
And at the same time, it both
mm-hmm.
means theorization, but also that both cultures can actually help each other right now.
Yes.
Because we don't know what the architectural concept is or architecture is, but we definitely
yes.
know the ways in which we are trying to pursue different types of environments and ambiences,
right?
And then the ways in which this creates different consequences for society, like healing properties or wherever everyone wants to bring it. That's what I find that it's interesting.
Mm-hmm.
There's not something interesting I want to say about the Corbusier example that is
yes.
really fun.
Please, I'm sure.
The fact that the Villa Sava actually there's a thread there. The ramps inside
mm-hmm.
were actually a navigation device that it was interested on.
Mm-hmm.
That you are constantly entering in context with the interior program,
mm-hmm.
with the exterior,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
by actually going through the ramp. The ramp is...
So here's what I would say. I mean, you're absolutely right. I'm just going to end with it. So I think, about the book, right? I don't know how long we can make examples. So we should keep one book. I should like put it in the safe, right? We should, because probably, like, you know, all the iPad owners anyway, burn them. Okay, so the book, you can say, okay, well, there's an interface. And that's why we like books. It's a very good interface. You don't have to plug it in, right? You can go very quickly, and there is an index at the end, there is a table of content. You have this kind of page have numbers. And it's a very sophisticated interface. Because, right, because remember, I mean, I'll show you what happens if you don't have this interface, right? I mean, this is what happens if so you just realize that the book is a very special thing, right? In fact, we should not find. Kind of what we did before, right? Okay, so here's
teachers are in Ukraine, and I'm like, well, you know, basically, you know, there's no, right? There's no, it's like very different, right? So the book is pretty nice, right? It's, like, okay, it's kind of hard, right? It's like, how do you, okay, now we have different stuff here, we can search, right? But it's different, right? Okay, but so is there any difference, right? Well, I think what we can say is that, and this kind of goes back to the idea of modularity, right? Where in the case of a book, we can abstract the interface from all the books. We can say that, let's say, most books, let's say, well, of course, some books have index, some have footnotes, but the whole idea of pages, page numbering, chapters, right? I actually don't know exactly what appears. Maybe we can have a Gutenberg Bible, but let's say, roughly for 5 years, all books use the same interface, and then you just put different content where. Okay? But and this interface provides you certain operations, right? Certain information management operations. You can basically get overview of a book, right, by going like this. It's non-linear, you can go back and forth. You know, so actually a book is, you know, a very sophisticated interface. Okay. Now, what about movie theater, right? Maybe some of you guys read something about apparatus theory from 70s, etc., etc. I mean, what about the movie theater, right? So there's a whole phenomenon of these movie theaters, these movie palaces, which emerged in 1910, 1920s. Is it also a particular interface? I mean, I think so, right? I mean, you go, you're like, well, okay, you go in, you sit in silence, you isolate it, you look at the movie from fixed position. Well, it's a particular interface because I don't know where, but you know, if you probably know about 19th century optical toys, right? All these little toys. I mean, it's very different interfaces. So, just a second. I have to finish the thought. Sorry, can you just wait? Let me get to one more. Okay, every time I flatten it, then you can say something. Before I flatten it, okay, because otherwise it's hard for me to finish. Okay, okay, it's too interrupt. So what I'd like to suggest is that interfaces always existed. We offered different functionality. So a book, for example, gives you a lot of control over the text. The movie theater doesn't give you control, in fact, it fixes you. Right? Now think about your 20th century radio. Well, you have frequency, right? You can go to Cairo and you know, you probably saw this. You know, all these old films where people are so excited, right? It's basically was the web today, right? Today you go to websites, but you know, at that time you just go like this and you go from one station to another station, right? You guys don't remember. Go right? To museums. Okay. And you also have control like loudness, right? It gives you a couple of controls, right? So we can say that both physical, mechanical, and electronic technology has always provided an interface to information, to a signal, to a message. So now we have to ask, no, this is good, because now we have to ask a much more specific question, how do interfaces available, I mean, first of all, operating system, right? Windows, etc. So how does the operating system and the applications and their interfaces, how are these interfaces different or are they from interfaces we had before? Wow. Okay, so it's very simple, right? So here we have, so we have Photoshop, right? We have a toolbox, we have all the stuff here. I mean, if you want, I can, let me load maybe something even more simple. Here's a QuickTime player, right? So here's another, for example, here's another, here's another interface, right? All the stuff here, just a second. Just to give one more example of something very, very simple. Just give me 1 second, sorry. Okay, well, you have Acrobat, okay, but here's a simple text. Okay. Yeah, so are there some differences? Please.
With a book, even if it is translated from another human language, it is always intelligible by a human. But
yes.
Through the computer, as far as I know, no one can read binary.
That is correct. So, up until a particular point in time, And I would say that actually, in some ways, it actually belongs here, right? Because it's actually maybe, I think you're absolutely right, except for what I mentioned duo. I mean, so this interface connects to this, right? Because the interface allows you to read the message, because the message is binary code, which you can't read by itself, right? So that's very important. At a certain point, the media is directly accessible by sensors, and then probably in the 19th century, with development of telegraph, well, with development of maybe telephone, gramophone player. Right? With cinema, you can say, well, you can actually look at the frames, but you don't really have to say what's going on. Right? So we're at different levels, but in general, we can say you no longer can directly access media. You have to have a separate interface which would read information and display it in a way which makes sense to your senses. Beautiful. Thank you. A plus. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to add one more button. Okay, I have to flatten. Okay, now I'm going to flatten, and after I'm going to add one more button, then you guys can talk again. Okay, it's flattened already. So I'm just going to add one thing here. Okay, it's kind of amazing. Keep going. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go maybe, well, I'm going to go like this. I'm going to go like this, and I'm going to go like this. And here I'm going to add one more thing, which machine lets me go. Yeah, it lets it. So I'm going to add one more thing, which is this property, right? Which I don't know how to call this, right? How do you call this new property that media is not directly accessible to your senses unless it's translated by the interface?
Opacity,
yes, beautiful. Okay, so it's very easy, right? It's very easy with you. You just gotta think about what's around you. That's easy. I don't know why Google is fierce, but it's easy. Just keep asking questions and just let the layers and it all comes out. Opacity. Opacity, and I'm going to say count directly, right? Directly, instead of C or C, C content, right? Wow, it's great, right? Okay. Anything else? So I can say that the interface, you know, kind of acquires new importance because it basically formats, right? It kind of reads and formats media. Anything? Okay, that's brilliant. Right? I don't have to say anything. You just, okay, what else?